So from Shush, we go into track number four. Oh, wow, only track number four. And track number four is entitled We March. I'm going to give it over to Player again to introduce this one.
When I first got this album, this was one track that was quote-unquote new as compared to the other tracks. So initially I liked it, but the shine has worn off over time a little bit. I mean, the track is nice and it has a good message and everything, but there's something about this song that lacks a bit of oomph in it. It has the marching samples in it, but it needs to be a bit heavier for my liking. A bit more military, a bit more marching band drums mixed to the foreground, a la the coda section of Sign of the Times. A bit more bombastic to make it a more defining statement.
Shaggy.
bombastic. But you've got Ricky P in there, Kirky J in there, Nona Gay. Like I said, it's good, but this space should have been reserved for Days of Wild or another outtake from this era. And We March should have been given the marching orders onto a B-side somewhere, I think.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Ooh.
Interesting. Toe Jam?
I sort of agree. This is probably the most skippable. Not that it's bad. It's got that Mixolydian sound again. So the first three out of the first four songs sort of have this similar kind of Mixolydian sound. It's got the siren and the screams and the baby cry, which is I totally agree with what Player said. The first time you hear it, I really enjoyed it, and I like the sample, that vocal sample. Whatever it is.
Yeah.
And I like the organs kind of staccato throughout it. These little tiny little stabs that you can hardly hear. They're good. But yeah, I kind of agree. It's a bit kind of happy for the you know, protest song it's trying to be.
Yeah.
But it's interesting because it kind of starts off and you think, oh, it's like a protest song. But then it sort of changes where it sort of goes into this, well, change comes from a within kind of mentality, which is interesting. Yeah, that's pretty much... The bass is really crazy. There's some crazy little bass, like samples and mucking around with bass sounds. They're cool. It sounds to me like it would have suited better on Emancipation. It sounds more like an Emancipation sound.
Yeah, I agree.
All right, Captain, what are your thoughts on We March?
Just like Toe Jam said, I think most people would say this song is the most skippable on this album. But for me, it's up there with the previous track on its level of likability. I like them both about the same. But I know most people would say if they could drop one track on this album, it'd probably be We March. But, you know, it's an album track. I wouldn't go so far to say it's filler, but it's not a big hit single either. It's an album track.
It's very much the morning after, isn't it? It's kind of a nice little song in between big songs that's not bad but not particularly memorable. So.
You know, but maybe it was filler because even Prince, he's played pretty much every track on this album, and yet, yeah, this one he's played a handful of times, and he's played pretty much most everything else on this album a fair bit. But I don't have much to say about it, really.
All right. I guess that takes it into me. We March. Not a lot to add, so this will be a very quick review, but really it's a meaningful song about equality and I think particularly racism and similar prejudices, the one for all and all for one. I think that's actually the segue that I was referring to earlier. What I do like about the song is those bass pops low in the mix, some chugging guitar, occasionally lots of voices. Sounds like a riot or a social group, you know, rally or outcry, which it obviously is about, you know, and it gives you the sense of a march, or, you know, it's audible that the song is to do with people marching down the street. But a lot of percussion elements thrown in, and a little bit too much. It's almost like they threw in everything in the kitchen sink, and I really wonder about how much of that is the Kirky J influence, considering that he's really... The only presence of Kirky J on this album is on this song, and then we all know what happened on Emancipation. So I think that's the thing that really... The beat isn't that great. I would have rather preferred a more organic-sounding, proper MPG just playing this out, you know, once or twice all the way through. But, you know, there's some nice melodies in there, whatever. The only thing I will say to close with my review of this song is that I think We March is probably the most similar to the song Sign of the Times in the 1990s. I can't think of any other track that took on so many social issues, particularly the issue of racism, in the same way that We March does. So from that point of view, I think it's certainly one of his most politically charged songs. It has been used on film, movie soundtracks, and on other compilation albums. And I think that where this song succeeds is its message, and what it says. Where it fails is it's a little bit of a mix mash approach. And if there was one song that I could take off this record, that would be it.
But this song, it reminds me of Free. It's probably just the actual marching, but it reminds me of that song.
All right. So We March goes into the single, the big single that was released about a year and a half before this album even saw the shelves of the record stores. Track number 5, The Most Beautiful Girl in the World. Take it away, Captain.
Okay, I'll say it again, overproduction. But I can possibly overlook that because the reason could have been that he had to make it obviously different to the original MPG Records release.
Yep.
So is that right?
Yep, that's right.
Anyway, the song itself I really like. It's a great, great song. Obviously, you know, it was it number one in Australia or number two? I can't remember.
One.
But it did very well.
Number one all around the world, I think.
It did number one in a fair few countries. I suppose it's a ballad, but it's still very poppy at the same time, so of course I like it. Amazing vocal performance. The high notes near the end of this song are just... And the low, even some of the low notes as well. It's just crazy. And you got all the lush backing vocals. Even the funny thing is, even though this technically is a song by The Symbol, it's a classic Prince song, which is just, it's funny. I don't like the outro of this album version. I like the fade on the original version, but this outro it's well done. I just don't really like it. I don't mind the video. It looked cabaret. He looked like, I've got to say, yeah, someone gets that joke. He looked like Liza Minnelli, right? I'm not the only one who thinks that.
Yeah.
The haircut. Yeah.
He's looking a bit girly in a song about the most beautiful girl. So.
I mean, apart from the Raspberry Beret video, which is a pretty similar sort of haircut, it was a bit funny.
Liza in her younger years.
Yeah. Yeah, it was number one in a bunch of places. But I think this song was what really... started him, actually it wasn't the start, but it was near the start, where he thought, I can release a ballad and it'll do really well. It like started the bad precedent of, I'm going to release singles, ballads. You know, he released his track, he got a number one, so then he got it in his head that he could, you know, I can make a hit, not a problem, I don't need a record company, and I can make a hit with a ballad. So both these things have been proven wrong time and time again since this lucky one-off. Anyway, something else I learned. Do you know why there are, like, a million versions of this track? Because Warner Brothers would only allow him to release one song away from Warner Brothers, so that's why he made so many different versions of the same song. That was hilarious. It's just classic Prince, you know?
Playing with the rules.
Really fun. It's like, okay, I can only do one song? Okay, I'll do about 18 different versions of it.
I.e. the most beautiful girl in the world maxi single, right?
Yeah, Mustang. Well, there's 7 there, there's Mustang Mix, there's Mustang 96.
But those versions are really nice, a lot of them, you know?
The Mustang Mix is great.
And then the most beautiful boy in the world. Let's really stretch it out. Yeah.
And there was the Spanish version as well.
That's right, yeah.
There's so many, and I just think that's hilarious. That's all I got to say.
Should say, the Beautiful Experience LP or vinyl or EP, whatever you want to actually, yeah, EP, CD or vinyl, that's quite a, I mean, for really stretching out the limits of one song. You see how he builds it up, and then you can, by the time you get to the single, you really appreciate the song a lot more, I think, but, you know, I'm probably digressing a little bit.
We'll get to that. I want to do that EP one day.
Right.
Won't be long, but I want to do it.
So, Player, the most beautiful girl in the world, excuse me. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, let's face it, this is only on here because it was a big hit and Warner's used it as a bargaining chip for it to get Gold Experience released.
Yeah.
But, of course, it had to be remastered to make it sound different to the previous release, non-Warner Brothers versions.
Did you say remastered?
Well, in the sense that, you know, to make it sound different. Like, he takes the master copies and, like, changes it around so that it's, you know, it sounds different from the other release versions.
UN.
Yeah. And what Prince has done here is he's taken the song, extended it a bit, and grabbed a big tub of sugar and tipped it all over the song by making it real vampy. He's added lots of additional harps. He's accentuated those sound effects. And there's other deliberate musicalities to make the song different, like in the second verse where the drums, there's a part where it sounds like a machine gun. You know, it really takes it over the top. The genesis of the song is great. I'll give it that. But I've said this on previous occasions, it's overdone for me, and I've heard it one too many times in too many arrangements.
Ooh. Okay.
But it is good. Like, I'm not saying it's a bad song. Obviously, it is a good song because it went number one in so many countries. But, you know, it came out in 94, and then by 95, I was done with this song.
Over it. Yeah. It did get played to death.
I did, yeah, so.
But even knowing the reasons that he changed it on this album, do you think this album version is overproduced?
It is very sugary. It is.
Because he could have just changed a couple of minor things to make it different from the original, and it wouldn't have sounded like, you know, this.
Yeah. So,
I mean, the big end with the, you know, you don't need that. But anyway.
That sort of ending is a good way to sum it up in, like, the live setting. Yeah. You know, when you're doing, like, a live version and on the record it fades out, it's a bit hard to finish up a song. But that way, if he wanted to do this live, that's a good way of finishing it up. So, yeah. Anyway.
Maybe that ending came from the live versions.
Maybe.
Maybe that's where he got it from. I don't know.
All right. Player, if you're...
I'm done on this one.
You're done on this. I've got a few things to say, and we'll take it over to Toe Jam. I mean, this is really, to me, a showcase for Prince doing the stylistics, Delphonics, and the many other, hundreds of other vocal R&B groups back from the 50s and 60s and early 70s. But it's a showcase for his dynamic range and his falsetto and his vocal mark. And the way he lays it all down is just incredible. I mean... And the bass notes on his vocals that he hits at about 314, 315 onwards are just sick. I mean, the guy's incredible. He just uses his voice as another instrument, as a tool in the studio. You really get...
Sick. as Claire Fisher would say.
As Claire Fisher said. And the notes from 330 onwards, and especially at 342, are just wild. I mean, I don't know that I can even... talk about them. I mean, it really is incredible, but at the same time, they're so high-pitched. He takes it to the nth degree. I mean, the player said it was extreme. It's beyond that. It is just a squeal right at the end
highest,
of the song.
The highest note right on the... I don't know if it's on this album version, but on the fade-out of the original, it's like, you know, 430, whatever it is. He gets... I mean, this song's in F-sharp. He gets up to a B, which is... It's bloody high.
Yeah, and
it's amazing.
And that's just the vocal, but you know, this is a great song. It was a good hit, a great single for him. And the lyrics are, you know, they're cherry pop, sugar coated, but it takes you back to that era. You know, out of this entire album, everything here is very kind of modern and very Prince-like. This is very much the sounds of the 60s and 60s
soul. It's a
song,
throwback.
You know? Yeah, it's a throwback jam, and it's a great song. Toe Jam.
I haven't got much more to add. I think most things have been said. I think for me, the hook of the song is just the lyric of the chorus. Could you be the most beautiful girl in the world? Like, that's just a hit, that lyric just right there. Like
the melody, yeah.
Yeah, and it's almost, for me, it's almost a little bit too simple, the melody and the chords. So it is very sugary in that sense. But it's very pure as well. Like, I think pretty well-intentioned. I can't help but wonder if it's kind of the title that he's had in his head for a while. And it's like he was going to wait for the right moment. And what's the right moment when, you know, he releases something outside of Warner Brothers? Well, I've got this killer chorus that is going to be number one regardless of who's singing it or who's playing it or whatever. So, but I think you guys have said most things about the music and the arrangement. It is, I kind of skip it on this album because for me, I find it hard to associate this song as part of this album because it was such a big song before the album came out. And even for me, who didn't get the album till later, like, this song was already... I already knew this song as a Prince song, so I normally kind of skip it in the context of the album. So I'm perhaps not as familiar with all the differences from the EP version. But yeah, so there we go. I don't have much more to say. It's a very good ballad.
One thing that I think I mentioned already was I really like the guitar in this song.
Oh, yeah, that's nice.
Just the little bits all over the place. They just sound nice. Like, in the chorus, it's just good.
Something else about the charts. This was actually Prince's first UK number one.
Yeah,
so
yeah,
it,
yeah.
It took him all those years, like all through Purple Rain, Sign of the Times, Diamonds and Pearls even. Like, this was his first UK number one. So that's pretty amazing.
See, and he got it in his head then. I can do it without Warner Brothers. I can do it with a ballad. That was the start of the... near the start of the that thinking, you know. when this song came out, I bought the CD single, and it didn't have Prince anywhere on it. On the front, there was just a picture of, like, all the flowers and the most beautiful girl in the world. And on the back, it just had a picture of his ass. Which is great. But,
I've got it here right in front of me. And it says on the front cover, like, sort of a hidden message, beauty inside. And then you open it up and you see that.
It's just classic Prince sense of humor. It's just great.
Actually, I think I remember something with that cover as well. There's all the, like, cutout pictures of girls and stuff. I think, from memory, it was like a competition.
Yeah.
Yep. He put an ad in newspapers looking for the most beautiful girl in the world. And he got... I mean, what a genius idea. Just to get pictures of women. What a genius idea. It was amazing. That's Prince for you. It's just... That was great. And then he picked however many and put all the pictures on the cover. And then, you know, a few of them were in the video, I think.
Yeah, that's right.
Along with Marva Collins.
Yeah.
Actually, it's interesting because there's a whole lot of... there was also some school principal that did something.
Yeah, that's Mark Collins,
That's right. Okay,
And he donated, like, you know, however, like $1 million or something to her, something preparatory school. I remember that.
Yeah. But I'm like Toe Jam with this song. Like, you know, I usually skip it. It's too sugary. If I sit through and listen to it, I'm in a diabetic coma by the end of it. It's just too sugary.
But we talked about this exact same thing with another song a while ago. That he, I think I said it, and I think Toe Jam agreed, he just walks the line, like the border of being sincere and not going too far and being totally sappy. It's just like right on that line. And some people think it's over, some people think it's not. You know, like Toe Jam said before, it's coming from a, you know, a sincere place. Anyway, that's all.
That was track number 5, and let's go into song number 6.
You're confusing me with these numbers.
Which is titled...
I'm going to buy the CD, which has 18 tracks.
Which is titled Dolphin.
Dolphin is track 8 on the disc for most people.
And song number 6 on the Pitch and Black podcast, Dolphin. Player.
I really like this song. This, to me, sounds like the Dream song. The underwater guitar pedal effect is used wisely, considering the subject material of the song. The lyrics are nice. The subject matter regarding reincarnation is tastefully done. And at the time, it was sort of regarded as another piece of the puzzle between killing off the Prince persona and rebirth of the symbol. For me, the definitive version is the Letterman version. And I always get thrown listening to the album version when he gets to the why does my brother have to go hungry line. When that comes in, I always forget that line's in there because I'm just sort of used to the Letterman version where he actually cuts that part out. And I like the coda section that features on The Undertaker with Michael B and Sonny T going into that freeform jazz trip, like the intro and outro and Lotus Flower. I would have liked to have had that featured on the album. But other than that, it's a favorite of mine. Really nice song.
Okay, Toe Jam.
It's very thick, this song, isn't it? There's so much happening. Very long chord progressions and just so many instruments happening at once. It's almost this recording a little bit too much at times.
Overproduced, would you say?
Yeah, maybe.
I'm just sucking that word in everywhere.
But yeah, I agree with the atmosphere that it creates with all the sort of watery effects and the tremolo effect on the guitar and even the chord progression. It's sort of this sort of up and down chord progression, almost like wave-like. You know, it's sort of this chord. It's got a pretty standard descending chord progression. Then it's got this crazy chorus progression and then this weird chromatic guitar synth line. It's got a cool bridge, like all the toms, Michael B's toms going off again. And there's a nice little classical bit at 240 as well. It's where he has that, it happened before. That's really cool, that bit. Harpsichord. And that's followed by a big guitar solo with keys, which is kind of similar to what he did on the Holy River, that sort of big climactic guitar solo. One little bit, I only just discovered this bit listening to it this week. At 325, there's this, in the background, I think it's in the right speaker, there's this tiny, crazy, like, keyboard sound that's just going really fast, like this little classical bit. That's really cool. Check that out, 325. And I like the video of this. It's just one shot, the camera, one shot the whole way through, and it just kind of zooms in on people, you know, zooms in
playing
on Prince.
Playing invisible instruments.
No, I think they're playing real instruments.
Morris Hayes playing the keyboard on a bed.
Oh, is
there's
he?
No keyboard there.
Yeah. Yeah, zooms in on Michael B and zooms out. It's kind of a cool little concept for it. Sort of has that homemade kind of feel to it. But yeah, if anything, I think this song is probably slightly overrated by the fans. It is a very good song, but I just always find it's almost too much. It's like Rich Chocolate Cake. Sometimes it's just too much. But it is a very interesting and unique song in his canon. So yeah, I'll leave it there.
Okay. Captain.
Dolphin, another great track. I don't understand why he didn't play this more live. Maybe it just didn't work that well, but as players said, the Letterman version was pretty good. But it's just a great straight rock song with a couple of weird little, you know, princely things in there to make it his song. And again, I really like the video. From what I remember, they don't have... I mean, Prince has got the cymbal gold guitar, but I think the others are all just like miming invisible instruments. This was just from my memory, though. But
pretty sure Michael B's got his drums.
I remember Morris playing the keyboard on a bed when there was no keyboard there. I'm 100% sure of that. I just remember that in my brain.
Must be just a video.
But
actually, it's one of those songs. Maybe if it had like a really highly produced video, it maybe would have given the song more justice, I think, because it's such a big, epic, thick song, and it's got this kind of cheap. You know, I said before it was good, but now thinking about it, maybe it was a bit of a lost opportunity.
Well, it was like a demo video. So let's just record this and chuck it out there. But yeah, same as Toe Jam. I like the change before the guitar solo. It's just nice. And then the great guitar solo, of course. You probably know this was the first music video aired on VH1 Europe. I just remember him there. There's pictures around. He was dressed all in white and he was pushing this like giant remote control, which was like, you know, bigger than he was. Wouldn't be hard, but see, Ali player got it. Jeez. But oh, great bass. Love Sonny on the bass. It's just a great bass line. Again, Sonny T and Michael B, they were born to play together. And this song's just another example of it. Yeah, that's it. Play it live. Play it live in Australia. Endorphin Machine, just play Gold Experience Tour.
Oh, wow.
Come to Australia. Play Endorphin Machine. Play Dolphin. But think of the others.
Yeah, that would be incredible. You're right about that, Captain. I'll finish off this review. I love this song. A couple of people might have said that it gets a little bit too much praise. Everything from the theme of reincarnation to the title to the dolphin sounds at the end, the reverb and the echo all throughout is really beautiful opening lines. Specifically, how beautiful do the words have to be before they conquer every heart or something like that?
The whole theme is really well thought out realized from the sound effects to, you know, everything. And is this like the first thing he's done about reincarnation?
I think.
Well, that's
there's a few
obvious.
References
that's,
in Emancipation.
Yeah, that's...
Yeah, it may be. It may be.
It's like a one-off thing. Like, oh, let's just have a look at this thing.
Yeah, and it's an interesting comment you make, Captain, because it's not in my notes and it's not what I was going to talk about, but you just prompted me to think of something. And I agree with you. It just... Everything about the song is so... It works. Everything works so well together. And I think, yeah, you're right. It's very well thought out.
You know, from the lyrics where he's saying, if you're underwater... Would you find me? And then you got, you know, all that guitar effects, sounds like it's underwater, all that stuff.
Yeah, and that part that you're talking about, I think it's at 226, 227, that actually sounds like it's underwater. I think a lot of it has got to do with the fact that of the way that they recorded the drums and that the way that Michael B is hitting the toms as well. And it makes it, it's this boom, boom, it gives us that really kind of deep sound. Like, what's it called? The Mermaid or something like that? It almost sounds like that in a way. It's kind of childish and playful in some sections. You know, it was released as a single, didn't enter the charts. There was really no commercial release available of the song, and I think it's really a shame. You know, the video was a bit lo-fi, let's put it that way. But there's so much happening here. I really thought Toe Jam in particular was going to jump on this song.
It's really 50-50 for me. I can listen to it sometimes and I really love it. And I just, when I listen to it before, I just,
This isn't the dream song that you always talk about?
Yeah.
It is. Of this album, it is. But I just don't know. When I listen to it before, I just, it's just a bit too much happening all at once.
Yeah, I can understand what you guys are saying about, you know, sensory overload and a lot of sounds. Because I agree, there is a lot happening here, and that's why I love it. Because so many of Prince's songs are so basic and stripped back, especially a lot of his funk stuff and even some of his rock songs. But this is just bells and whistles galore. The other thing that I love about it is it's got the perfect blend of acoustic and electric mix. Mm-hmm. Because if you really hear this and take the time to listen to this, there's so much acoustic guitar in this song, it is not funny. It's all underneath the rhythm tracks and forms part of the rhythm tracks in the song. Again, lots of spacey synths and synth work, all manner of keyboard sounds on this, presets galore. Not a lot, but there's some double harmony that they're using and some counter melodies here and there, and that classical bit of piano or keyboard that Tojem was talking about, and there's all these little diddle 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 diddle, all these descending things and vocals all over the place. Bass lines by Sonny T are cool, and the drums are so filling and they're fat with a PHT. Lots of key stabs. You know, by the end of it, I'm drenched. I'm drenched in the sea of
tranquility,
tranquility of dolphin water. It just really, he does lay it on thick with this song, and I think it's almost like that midway point of this album, where things take a turn in a very different way after these songs about social and sexual and human equality and injustice and love and all this kind of stuff, and then Dolphin, and then side two for the party tracks. But it's one of my favorite songs off the album, and I would love to hear a live version one day. But it's a very special song by this guy, by this so-called pop artist. So okay, from Dolphin we go to Now. Let's take Captain to open this one up for us.
Okay, rap. I know every word of this, and out of all his attempts at rap, I'll probably like this more than most of them. It's just, I like it. Musically, there's not that much happening at all, except little guitar noodling here and there. But it's all about the rap and the backing vocals in the chorus. You know, it's Prince. There's always some funny lyrics. That always helps. And what's with all the dope references, though? He's hardly ever really mentioned it at all. And then, you know, is he trying to be cool?
I think it's just a big metaphor where, like, you know, light us up and take a hit. It's kind of like the metaphor of, you know, the hit is the musical experience kind of thing.
Yeah, I agree with that.
Interesting.
Yeah. And I always thought it was a bit strange that he included stuff like that in a song when he'd never really mentioned it before. But I just thought, you know, he's trying to be cool. He's doing rap, so straight away there he's trying to be cool and fit in. So why not include, you know, Pod as well? I just love this song. He gets more and more crazy throughout this song, and then the last chorus, he's just screaming his head off, like a total mental case.
It's hilarious to listen to, isn't it? It's a guy just so losing
good.
It.
And like it distorts, it just, it's so good. He just lost it, and I love it. I like this song. It's great.
Okay, player.
Again, I'm going to have to call the Beautiful Experience TV version as the definitive version. This one's a bit too slow and countrified guitar-wise for my liking. It is good, but it sounds like Prince has loaded up 88 keys of a sampler with riffs, vocals, and he's just triggering them off different sections and having a ball with it. Some really great arrangement work in this one, and some funky horn lines. The downside, though, are the various random noises and screams and dog barks and panting and yelps and all that sort of stuff that's sprinkled throughout. It gets a bit grating for my ears. But, yeah, it's a funky little song. However, I think the live version on that TV movie was a lot funkier.
Okay. And Toe Jam, now.
You want me now?
Now. Let's go into it.
This song's crazy. And it's pretty good. It's a bit overproduced. I will agree with player. It's like Dolphin. There's just a little bit too much happening at times, but there's lots of things I like about it too. My favorite thing in this song is just that baritone sax. And I think it's in the left speaker, and it's just the beat just before every sort of phrase. You just hear this burp, and it's cool. Classic use of baritone sax. And it just runs all the way through the song. It sort of reminds me of, you know, the George Clinton song, Everything Is On The One. So much the song, but the concept of that, where it's like, you know, the now is on the now. That's the one kind of thing. Mm. It's sort of, that's the vibe I get. What I like about it is I think there's three main verses, and every time it comes in, the background music is, or the background beat or, you know, playing is completely different each time. That's cool. And there's one that's just completely whack, where it's just like this, la, 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 la. It's just, while he's rapping a verse over it, it's just, what the hell is that? Out of nowhere, which is cool.
I was smoking the good stuff that day.
Yeah, it's like that. It's a bit, you know, what was he smoking? The horns kind of sound a bit sampled. But it's all right. My favorite bit of the song is just, it's at 135, and it happens a few times where he does the, this ain't about this, this ain't about that, and it kind of builds, and, you know, the chants are happening as he, you know, he's saying a word, and they say a word as well, and it kind of builds and builds, and then it's like, now! And they just go crazy. But I think the thing that kind of kills it for me a bit is that the stupid chant, 3-4, 3-4, 94, whatever it is, that just sounds a bit, it kind of dates that a bit. And I agree with Player, when you hear that in the TV version without that bit, and you just hear the silky now vocals, it sounds so much better without that silly chant over the top of it. But it's pretty crazy kind of track, and I guess it kind of works well sort of central in the sort of in the center of the album here, I guess, sort of leading towards these last few big tracks coming up. So that's my review of Now.
Okay, all right. Now supposedly improves self-esteem. And I can vouch for that. I mean, I'm not a massive fan of the song, but it's got a lot of interesting elements, and like Tojim said, it is crazy and all over the place. There's this weird modulated loudspeaker chant of freaks on the floor. I think that's what they're saying, freaks on the floor. Something
yeah, that's
like
it, that. Of course. Yeah.
And that's okay, along with the chants in other parts of the song. They create that kind of house party vibe from the mid-90s. The bass line is really cool, though. I like it. It's not, obviously, it's not reggae, but it's, yeah, I don't know what you'd call it. It's just kind of like a house party track. Minneapolis-style reggae, let me put it that way.
Ragga.
Yeah. The systematic and gradual increase of the horn lines at 259 are funky. I do like that. But the biggest thing that really I listened to this song for is Prince's aggression, if you want to call it that. And he's the raw vocals, his voice breaks, he's screaming. There's just an overall and general loss of control and inhibition on his end, which is absolutely hilarious to listen to, especially towards the end. He just, I mean, just picture him delivering that vocal in the booth and his face while he sings that. I would be pissing myself on the floor. The legs have gone. I'd be on the floor just laughing my head off at that, and which is great. And it's a hodgepodge of sounds. It kind of reminds me in many, many ways in its production value to Beck's first album. If everyone remembers the single that came around the same time, Loser. You know, Loser.
Yeah, yep. I can definitely hear that.
Yeah, there's a lot of similarities production-wise and even musically.
Odelay, was that it?
Yeah, no, it was actually...
Odelay Gold, maybe?
Gold, yeah.
Yeah, I think so.
Gold Experience.
Exactly. There you go. But it's raw. It's a very... It's like a mixed bag of lollies, you know? You never know what you're going to get when you listen to this song. If you're in a good mood, you kind of go with it. If you're not feeling the beat, hip-hop-esque vibe, then maybe you don't. But it's just a collage of sounds, and it's more so a collage of sounds, I think, than a song per se. But yeah, overall, just it's a pretty cool summer jam by the MPG, and it's on the album, and it suits the tone well, especially with what's coming up next. But let me just say that without Now, We March, and arguably P Control, cutting this down from 12 to 9 tracks, you potentially would have, in my opinion, the best Prince album that he's ever done. And if I want to be a little bit less, you know, out there, I might include Sign of the Times and Purple Rain in the trilogy. But, you know, you look at Endorphin Machine, Shush, The Most Beautiful Girl, Dolphin, 319, and everything that's about to come up. I think I might have a case there. So. Sorry?
319? Seriously?
Yeah, we're going to get into that.
I got one more thing to say about this song. What Player said before, how he and the other song before, you prefer the live version. Wasn't that basically the reason that Days of Wild wasn't put on here, or you know, it was left off?
Wasn't the story that he wasn't happy?
He didn't think the studio version lived up to the live version, so he just didn't put it on.
Mm.
Which is interesting to base, you know, putting a song on an album based on, well, the live version's better, but it's an album version.
Yeah, but the problem with this one for me is it had the Fury effect where I heard the live version first, and then the studio release, I heard it sort of that in that order, so I kind of like Fury on Saturday Night Live. I sort of prefer that version over the... If I heard this first, I'd probably like this, you know, just as the same equally, but it just had that where the order that I listened it into has affected the way I sort of view it.
Yeah.
And appreciate it, yeah.
Actually, now that I think of it, I've got to add, towards the end, there's that really cool horn part again, where it goes something like... And then they say, yeah, that's cool. So there's that kind of stuff that's in there, and you just kind of think, yeah, this is decent track.
That'd be a sample, but is it a sample of MPG horns, or is it actually just him on a keyboard?
It sounds like horns to me.
Yeah, it does. You'd never know. Sounds like the horn heads.
Yeah.
So, that was then, this is now, and now we're about to go into 319. Any fans in the house of this?
Yeah.
Okay, player, take it off my hands.
Yeah, I like this song. This is another one I had heard in advance by sitting through Showgirls just to hear it.
I'm sure that's the only reason you were watching that.
Yeah. Don't talk to me about the guy sitting like 3 or 4 seats down from me, back and over his lap. Anyway.
Wow.
Oh, this is a really good Prince song, this one.
He really liked this song.
319 is really well mixed. The production is really popping and snappy. The drums have a really big sound to it. And whenever I hear this song production-wise, it reminds me of Robert Palmer for some reason.
Oh, he beat me to it.
Like, seemed to be irresistible.
Beat me to it.
Yeah.
You know, the funny thing is, all three of you, Toe Jam said before about Robert Palmer, player, you just said it. MC said, yeah, I never heard that at all.
Well, I see Prince standing there with his Nikon digital SLR with identical-looking girls behind him taking photos. That's a visual I get. Sound-wise, it sounds like a slightly faster version of Cream, and I think this has hit potential or single release potential. It's structured really nicely. It gets to the point. It doesn't spin off into wacky variants or different directions.
It doesn't go into salsa.
Yeah, it doesn't do it. It just sticks to it. It's really, really good. Really tight. The horn head accents are a nice touch. It's not overdone. And if Elizabeth Berkeley was the inspiration of this song, then Prince can sit through some old reruns of Saved by the Bell and write tunes like this. That's fine with me.
All right. And any other fans in the house of 319? Let's go to maybe Captain.
I'm sort of on the fence with this one. I mean, it's a good song. It's just, you know, total guitar rock. But why is the track 305? He could have padded it with 14 more seconds from the previous four. That just annoys me every time it comes up. I'm like, 305? You got a 14-second phone call just before it. Why didn't you just include it and make the track 319? I never understood
that. Well, maybe that's the whole point.
Oh, he did it on purpose to annoy me at the point. Yeah. There's not much to say about it, really. You just got funky guitar in there. Player said it's well mixed. It's everything's just in the right place. It's not the strongest song. It's not the strongest chorus. But, you know, it does the job. It was a soundtrack song, you know. It's in the background. You're not meant to listen too much to it. Don't focus too much on the details.
Oh, wow. Come on, man. Jeez, going hard on this.
I don't mind it. I don't skip it. It's just, like, for me, this is like We March. It's just another album track. It's not a hit. It's not a filler. It's just there. See, this is one of the ones he didn't play live much either. I think he got either it didn't work that well live, or it just wasn't that strong a track to play live. That's my feeling. Yeah.
All right. Well, now I'm going to take it off you before we hand it over to Toe Jam to close it out, because this song does remind me a little bit of Addicted to Love and Cream, but this is pure typical vintage Prince updated from the 90s. This is an awesome song. I mean, at 3 minutes, 5 seconds, you wouldn't think there'd be that much to say about it, but it is brilliant. I think it's an awesome track. It's so funky, the funky guitar playing in and out of it continuously. It's so sparse. It's got this really sparse drum beat with some cool chugging guitar chords, this messy sound with a bit of fuzz tone, mashed potato funk grooves thing going on there.
Yeah.
And these overloaded and like over amplified power chords. What are those distorted noises in the background? Does anyone know what they are? Those things that go, like, what is that?
This is some sort of synth bass thing. It's cool. Yeah. That bit's cool.
Yeah.
It sounds like a guitar revving up or something.
Yeah. It's throughout the whole song.
Yeah. It gives it the drive throughout the song.
Yeah. And the beat, like I said, it's steady and it's cool. And these short horn lines that are so playful, but they're really effective in the song. I don't know how Prince manages to make such a cool song out of so little. There's like nothing, there's nothing to this. If the four of us sat around in a studio, and I know the four of us maybe aren't, it's not as if we're the best example to use, but take any good musician, for example, or even composer, for argument's sake, or more so composer, and sit them down in the studio and say, okay, you've got this drum beat, you can come up with a few verses and a chorus. Oh, three by chords. The way, yeah, three chords. By the way, don't use any bass because in the traditional sense, there's no bass in this song that I can hear. And yeah, put out a cool little dance track that people can groove to, bob their head to. You know, it's almost like a Kiss for the 90s in a way. Go right ahead. I mean, how does he do it? How does he make something so awesome? In my opinion, it's a great track. But even if you think it's half decent, how does he do it with so little? I just don't know. But there's some funny stuff here. The sounds of the camera, that is just hilarious. It's crack
comic
me
book,
up.
That bit.
It is comic book. And I love it. I love every bit of it. And the funniest one for me is when he says, because he's got this, it goes ching, 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 like he's, the camera's going off. But the one that I love the most is after the line, when he sings, I've got a good shot, and he goes, ching, put your leg on the chair. I just love you got to go back and listen to the song again. Because like I said, he uses that element throughout the song as part of like a motif. But then he just puts this one ching flash right after that line. Pure comedic timing, genius timing there. And I've got a left to right grin on my face. This is just talent, pure, unabashed, unbridled talent. And is it the greatest song in this genre? No, that he's done better, but what a track. Come on. Toe Jam, what are your thoughts?
I just thought it was funny before when you mentioned it in the sort of grand songs of this album. Like, this is probably one of the, when I think of this album, this is not in the top five songs that I think of, but it's good for what it is. And I like all the things you've said. I always find the hi-hat is just too loud for me. Just this ch-ch-ch just throughout the whole thing in the left speaker. I just wish I could turn that hi-hat down a bit. It's kind of like the cowbell in Endorphin for some people. The second thing I've got written here is Robert Palmer, obviously. I can definitely hear Simply Irresistible in there somehow. I think it's in that when the chorus goes to the different chord in the chorus that sort of stays on that note. I can hear it stopping and going, Simply Irresistible. but it never, never happens. Nice little lyric in there at 116, let your fingers do the walking.
Oh, yeah.
Bit of a, Prince will turn anything, even an advert slogan into sexual innuendo somehow.
Probably. But hold on a second. I don't want to interrupt your review too much, but the complete line is when I just want to holler, scream, and shout when you let your fingers do the walking in and out. Yeah. I mean, that takes an entirely new context from when I'm sitting.
Yeah, it's not about looking up phone numbers for that one.
Back to Toe Jam.
I love the bit at 1 minute 40 where just out of nowhere he's like, watch this. And then there's this crazy weird, like, sound like a saw. Wow, what the hell?
Oh, the sound of that guitar. Yeah, I love the sound.
Yeah, it's like it's reversed or something. Yeah, the tone
of that guitar sounds so good.
It's just like a saw, yeah. But that's pretty much it. It sort of just plods along then. It has some nice little chicken scratch towards the end and... But like you said, it's a song of not that many elements that manages to pull it off somehow. But it's not really super memorable for me.
How funny are the lyrics? Lock the door and kill the phone. My camera, you and me alone. We'll make a picture. Or we'll see and go, 319. You just get this image of the MPG hanging around looking at photos going, that's 319. That's 321.
Yeah, I've got to agree with MC. He made, a decent song out of very little. And somehow it pulls it together.
There's just nothing there.
There's a lot of humor in this album, isn't there? With P Control Now and this one now.
Hmm.
Like, there's three sort of blatantly comical kind of songs, which is good.
But yeah, I've got to agree with Toe Jam as well. This song's probably in the bottom three of the album for me.
Wow. Well, I disagree with you guys wholeheartedly. I mean, this is... Yeah, completely the opposite for me. This is a great track.
Yeah.
Great. This is filthy. This song is filthy.
Yeah, it's on this album.
Yeah, and
I'll say this. I'd agree that it's in the bottom three of the album, but it's still a good song. So that says a lot about the album, doesn't it?
Mm. I mean, there's not a bad track on this album, really. I mean, you could say a few songs sound dated, but, how can they not be? They were recorded in 1994. They're going to sound like they're from 1994. You can't help that.
319, the song, though, it is so, like, it's just about the hottest of women.
Mm.
Unless I'm missing something, it's got to be about that. And it's just so overtly about that, that I just love it. I think it's also about, you know, the theme. I'm just thinking, he's just singing about, and he's wearing what he's thinking about on his sleeve. You know, he's like saying, she is just a nasty piece of work in the best, very best possible way. So, yeah, props to 319.
It's always annoyed me that when people say a song sounds dated. I mean, by almost any standard, you know, of course, it is dated. It physically can't be anything but dated because it is. But that's not a bad thing. I don't know why that's a bad thing for a song to sound dated. I've got no problem with an album sounding, you know, like the era that it came from.
That's a good point.
That's half the charm of, you know, half the albums in history.
Yeah.
Is that they sound like, you know, you listen to Beach Boys, it sounds like 60s, because it is. You know, this sounds like mid-90s Prince, because that's what it is.
Oh, you make a very good point.
I don't see that as a bad thing for something to sound dated.
No, not at all.
But some people think it's awful. You know, how many people hate the 80s because, oh, it's the 80s? 80s is the best friggin' pop songs ever written.
And let's go into the next track before we start up another debate on this show.